Do you think, in some sense, the few people that have turned down the prize made a much more powerful statement? I don't know if you're familiar in the space of mathematics with the Fields Medal and yes. Grigori Perelman,
yes.
who turned down the prize. I've committed, one of the reasons I started this podcast is I'm going to definitely talk to Putin. I'm definitely talking to Perelman, and people keep telling me it's impossible. I love hearing that because I'll talk to both. Anyway, but do you have a sense of why he turned down the prize? And is that a powerful statement to you?
Well, what I read is that, you're talking about the mathematician.
The mathematician turned down the prize.
What I read is that he was disappointed by the response of the community, the mainstream community, the mathematicians, to his earlier work, where they dismissed it, they didn't attend to the details and didn't treat him with proper respect because he was not considered one of them.
Yes.
And I think that speaks volumes about the current scientific culture, which is based on groupthink and on social interaction rather than on the merit of the argument and on the evidence in the context of physics. So in mathematics, there is no empirical basis. You're exploring ideas that are logically consistent. But nevertheless, there is this groupthink. And I think he was so frustrated with his past experience that he didn't even bother to publish his papers. He just posted them on the archive. And in a way, it's saying, you know, I know what the answer is, go look at it.
And then, again, in the long arc of history, his work on archive will be remembered and all the prizes, most of the prizes will be forgotten. That's what people don't kind of think about. Is when you look at Roger Penrose, for example, is another fascinating figure. You know, it's possible, and I forgive me if it's, I'm sure, my ignorance, but he's also did some work on consciousness. He's been one of the only people who spoke about consciousness, which for the longest time and is still arguably outside of the realm of the sciences.
Right.
It's still seen as a taboo subject. And he was brave enough to explore it from a physics perspective, from just a philosophical perspective, but like with the rigor, like proposing different kind of hypotheses of how consciousness might be able to emerge in the brain. And it's possible that that is the thing he's remembered for if you look 100 years from now, right? As opposed to the work in the black holes, which fits into the kind of fits into what the current scientific community allows to be the space of what is and isn't science.
Yeah, it's really interesting to look at people that are innovators, where in some phases of their career, their ideas fit into the social structure that is around them, but in other phases, it doesn't. And when you look at them, they just operated the same way throughout. And it says more about their environment than about them.
Well, yeah, I don't know if you know who Max Tegmark is.
Yes,
I just recently talked to him.
He's a friend of mine.
I just recently talked to him again. And he was a little bit more explicit about saying, you know, being aware, which is something I also recommend, is like being aware where the scientific community stands and doing enough to get, like, move along into your career, in your career. And yeah, it's the necessary evil, I suppose. If you are one of those out-of-the-box thinkers that just naturally have this childlike curiosity, which Max definitely is one of them, mm-hmm. is sometimes you have to do some stuff that fits in, you publish and you get tenure and all those kinds
right.
of things.
But the tenure is a great privilege because it allows you to, in principle, explore things that are not accepted by others. And unfortunately, it's not being taken advantage of by most people. And it's a waste of a very precious resource.
Yeah, absolutely.